Well, good morning, everybody. It's so great, as always, to have each and every one of you here with us today. Welcome to those that are visiting, those that call Asbury home, and those that are watching online. It's great, as always. A couple quick announcements to get the service started. Church directory, we mentioned there earlier that it's being updated. There is a master copy, which is located in the fellowship hall on the bulletin board. We ask that you review the information. If it is correct, initial it. If it needs to be corrected, there are forms to fill out. Also, new attendees, if you'd like to be in the directory, fill out these forms. You can use an existing picture. You can use the picture that's already in the bulletin, or the bulletin, sorry, the directory. Or Mike Cowie is here to take photos. He'll be taking photos today and on November 3rd. And it is asked that all submissions need to be in by the morning of Monday, November 4th. This way, Lisa can get started on that. Reminder of a time change that is happening next week. Reminder that it is time to fall back. You are going to get an extra hour of sleep. Yeah, woo! There we go. So remember that, because if you don't, then that could really mess up your Sunday. So, and Ed, do you have an announcement for everyone here for today?
Thank you. Morning. It's that time of year again, build a mountain of food. It's the only time of the year I get up here to make these announcements. I just want to make a, thank you. Build a mountain of food is here, coming again in 2 weeks or 3 weeks time. I just wanted to make a brief history of Asbury's involvement in the food bank and in the mountain of food. Hugh Colton came to the mountain of food, or the food bank here in 2007. And asked the board, I was on the board with Ed Chouinard, and we agreed. And we started that year, and it was a success. We collected 3,200 pounds of food and $1,400 in cash. And within 3 years, the offer of the Build a Mountain of Food went out to 9 other communities. They accepted, and it's still going. It goes down as far as Delta, there's 9 other communities. And since then, the CP Holiday Train, in response, has now had the annual stop here in Perth due to the success of this event. And as of 2023, we've collected now 2,120,000 pounds of food. staggering number, and $1,698,000 cash. And this all goes to our community. It stays here in Perth. So anyways, we're looking for volunteers now. We did all 4 stores, which was 32 volunteers. It got to be a bit much, and after about 5 years, we decided just to do 2 stores. So now we're looking for 16 volunteers. And it's basically the volunteers have been in 70 plus. And now that was in 2007. So now we're in 80 plus. So anyways, we're looking for families, younger families, and bring your children, your grandchildren, if you're a senior, for that experience, so that the kids can just be involved in helping out the community. So anyways, I have a sign-up sheet here. I'm just looking for 16 volunteers, and it's 3 weeks from now. It's a 2-hour commitment, just 2 hours on a Saturday, November the 16th. Thank you.
Good morning. Great to see you this morning. You know, if you could see into the spiritual realm, you would know that there are angels all around. You would see that Jesus is here in a special way. You would know that God has come close to us, and he invites us to draw close to him. So we've come, and we're going to worship today. We're going to reflect. believe God has a word for us today. So let's open in prayer. Thank you so much, Lord, for this opportunity to come into your presence, remember who you are, look at how we are called to be and live even in the middle of hard times. And I'm asking, Lord, that you would inspire praise and worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning again. The call to worship this morning is from Psalm 116. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy because he turned his ear to me. I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. Please stand together as we declare to God, he is always.
Asbury kids, you can come forward for time of prayer this morning with Pastor Brent.
Ah, great to see you people this morning. Let me pray for you. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for these kids. I pray, Lord, that they would early come to know you, and Lord, that you would help them to grow up in wisdom and help them, Lord, to find you and put their faith in you. But more than that, Lord, I'm asking for their Sunday school teachers and that you would bless them as they teach. And Lord, I pray that our church would be a church that's full of love and grace as we see these kids grow up. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Desert, when all that's within me feels dry. This is my prayer in shall remain. I will rejoice. I will declare. When favor and providence flow, I know I'm filled to be emptied again. The seed I've received, I will sow.
Our scripture reading is found in Psalms 13. How long, Lord, will you forget me? Forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, Lord, my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him. And my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me.
You amaze me. You my strength, you're my defender. You're the shelter from the storm. Through these trials, you've always been faithful. You bring healing to my soul.
Father, I ask that as we look into your word this morning that you would encourage, strengthen. I'm praying, Lord, that you would give the people who need this word just a fresh touch from you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, last week we started a series called Psalms for Your Life. Oh, by the way, those who are watching online, welcome. It's great to have you here. We're going to be doing communion at the end of the service, and so if you have juice or crackers or bread, and we're going to be celebrating, and I would welcome you to celebrate along with us. Started this series, Psalm for Your Life. Last week, we looked at a psalm of wisdom. This morning, we're going to look at Psalm 13. It is a psalm of lament. You use psalms of lament, you use lament when life just sucks, right? You've been there where it's just hard. Now, it's a little weird preaching on lament sometimes, because I know that most of you have areas of your life right now that you lament, but you're not in this place where life is crushing you, where grief has overwhelmed you, where pain in your life wants to become the primary focus. I also know that there are a number of you, a small number of you, but a number of you who are there. So when we come to lament, it will presently resonate with a minority of you. And yet, when we look around the world, there is so much to lament. Radical evil scars the lives of many people. And it is right and good to lament with those who find themselves in a season of lament. By choosing Psalm 13 as a psalm for your life, I want to show you how the people of God have dealt with pain. I want to give you some tools that you can use right now or in a season where lament comes, and there are seasons where life is challenging for all of us. You'll have some tools to work with. Put it in your back pocket. Bring it out at that time. I hope you'll remember Psalm 13. You don't have to go looking for pain to exercise lament, because life will bring enough pain for you. So we come to church on Sundays because, well, it is a day that the Lord rose from the dead. On that day, he conquered evil and sin and death, and our services usually are upbeat because that's something worth celebrating. And a lot of you tell me that you feel a lot better when you leave than when you came, and it's just a wonderful thing where you come to a service and it's upbeat and it's wonderful. However, there can be some unintended consequences of that. Sunday celebration, it looks like we should be celebrating all the time, but that's not true. There are times and there are places to lament. The message that can be caught is that, well, we should always be happy and joyful. But there are some times when we're called to be the direct opposite in terms of lamenting. So when we encounter deep pain, we tend to do one of three things. We tend to deny our pain, tend to detach from our pain, we tend to drug our pain. When I say we deny it, we just, that's okay. Doesn't really matter. Oh, you know, or we can spiritualize it. Oh, yeah, God's got this. And we can spiritualize, all things work together for good. And we just kind of deny that it's there. Problem is when you deny and you try to stuff down your emotions, it will eventually pop up someplace else. It will, and not necessarily where you stuffed it down, it's like whack-a-mole, right? You whack it down here and it'll come up here. And Or we can detach from our pain. We essentially numb ourselves. We don't allow ourselves to feel anything. That's painful. I'm not going to look at it. I'm just going to live my life over here. I'm going to ignore this part of my life. Of course, when you detach yourself from your pain, you also wall yourself off from all the good emotions as well, right? So you don't experience joy and peace and grace. We can deny it, we can detach from it, or we can drug ourselves. We, of course, can use alcohol. Apparently, drugging ourselves is a strategy that's well used in Perth. You take a look at the number of cannabis stores around here. Like, I mean, you're right. You know, the pain's there. It's just we drug ourselves. Of course, you can drug yourselves in other ways, too. Like, I mean, you can go down the rabbit hole of TikTok or YouTube shorts or Instagram reels. You can do it in socially acceptable ways, like become a workaholic and just drug yourself with work. You can make yourself so busy that, well, we don't have a chance to think about the pain. But if you're a follower of Jesus and you're in a season of lament, there's a better way to deal with your pain. You heard it read. Let me read it to you again. Psalm chapter 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? This is a psalm of David. Can you hear it? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me. Answer. Lord, my God, give light to my eyes or I'll sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I've overcome him. And my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. This is a psalm of David. David was from one of the most insignificant families in Israel, yet God directed Samuel to anoint this lowly shepherd as king. Problem was is that Israel already had a king, a mad king to be sure, but a king. But David went from being this lowly shepherd to being anointed a king. He went on to find himself in battle, and David killed Goliath, and he became a hero. Well, he had this hero status, and that status helped him to attain the position of musician to the king. A mad king, and he fell out of favor with the present king. So he went from there to being stalked, being hunted, and he was having to hide in the wilderness, and he was running for his life. He spent 10 years in the wilderness. God had anointed him to be king. Samuel had said, this is going to happen. But he was in the wilderness. And he's fleeing for his life. And it often it would come that close to Saul catching him and putting him to death. Death seemed so close at hand. It seems like everyone had deserted him. It felt like God had deserted him. And that's where we pick up this psalm. At least this is David's story. I told you the story that's going on the outside, but this is the story of his heart. What's going on the inside? Wasn't only his body that was in a wilderness, his heart was there as well. Verse 1, how long, Lord? How long? Will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? When you're in the wilderness, you wonder about a lot of things. Has God forgotten you? Does God care about you? When David says, how long will you hide your face from me? That's a reference to God's graciousness, God's attentiveness, God's kindness towards you. And when his face is towards you, it's like we have the blessing of God. But when his face is hidden, it seems like the blessing has been removed. David was anointed king by the prophet of God, and yet he felt like God had forgotten him. Have you ever been there? Have you ever wondered if God was there? And if he is there, have you ever wondered that he cared? Have you ever wondered, God, have you forgotten me? Why is it that when I pray, it feels like my prayers are hitting the ceiling? Why is it, Lord, that I come and everybody are having this experience of worship and my heart feels dead? Have you ever felt like God has totally turned his away from you? Verse 2, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have such sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? If you've ever had the kind of thoughts I was describing, you can identify with David. Can you imagine being anointed king and then spending the next 10 years of your life? A decade of your life on the run? I can just hear David's thoughts. Maybe God won't come through with his promises. If I killed, then, well, not only am I dead, but my faith in God is problematic. Can I really trust God? Will God do what he said he would do? You can imagine him wrestling with his thoughts day after day. Maybe I've done something to disqualify me from being king. Yeah, I ate the bread that was meant for priests and I lied to the Philistine king and I killed some people in war and maybe God no longer cares for me because of what I've done. Have you ever had to wrestle with your thoughts? You have self-doubts. You have God doubts. If you have, then you'll know what the wilderness is all about. I know that some of you know what it is like to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and your mind is on this hamster wheel and you're worrying about finances or you're worrying about relationships or you wonder if God's going to provide and your mind goes, and spins, and you wonder and you worry about a child, or you worry about what's past, or you worry about a business, or you worry about a friend, or you worry about a secret coming out, you worry about a betrayal, and your mind just runs. Some of you have had doubts because you prayed for something really important for you, and it seems like God hasn't come through. Some of you have had doubts because of sin, and you wonder, well, can God still love me even though I... dot, dot, dot. You ask yourself, where is God? David says, every day I have sorrow in my heart. If you're in the wilderness, then you're acquainted with these feelings of sorrow, that life isn't what it should be, and sadness. You know what depression is like, maybe mild, maybe deep. You may or may not be able to fake it on the outside. Those around you may or may not know anything about your private battles, but you know, and it's hard, and you struggle. You're just surviving. You hear God's promises of, that I've come to give you life and give it to you abundantly, and all you can do is survive to the next day. Verse 13, or verse 3, I should say, Psalm 13. Look on me and answer. Lord my God, give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. I'm going to die. If you've ever been in the wilderness and you're a Christian, then you're probably very familiar with prayer. David prays to God for three things: look, answer, give light. God, turn your face towards me. Look at me. Don't forget that I exist. Be gracious to me. Let your blessing fall on me. God, don't oppose me. Bless me. You pray. Then he prays, God, answer me. God, answer my prayer. Get me out of this situation, or get me through this situation, or God, change this situation. God, can't you see I'm in pain? God, can't you see that I'm hurting? God, help. Answer me, please. God, help. Give light to my eyes, O Lord. Give light. I don't understand why. Would you light up my mind so that you could show me why? If I knew why, well, then this burden would be easier to bear. If I understood that you were working in this situation, well, that would be one thing. But right now, I'm in the dark, and that's all I can see. I don't know what to do. I don't know which way to turn. I feel helpless. I feel hopeless. Dear God, give light to my eyes. God, if you don't come through, I'm going to die. Ten years in the wilderness. And some of those 10 years were praying these first three verses. And then he sees verse 4, and my enemy will say, ah, I've overcome him. And my foes will rejoice when I fall. Lord, those who have oppressed me, they've seen my faith in you. Those who have sinned against the righteous, they feel smug. And God, it's not only I who'll be put to shame, but I've been telling people I've been trusting in you, and, you know, will I be put to shame? Will your name be sullied? Don't know if you've ever been in the wilderness. Some of the wildernesses are worse than others. Some are bad, but you know you're going to make it. Then there's others that are so barren, you wonder if you will ever get out. There are times when you're in the wilderness and it feels like night, and God has removed all sense of his presence from you, and you can't feel his presence, and you can't get anything out of his word, and you can't seem to pray, and you don't seem to have any light. The old mystics used to talk about this as the dark night of the soul. And if you've ever been there, you know how dark it can be. Your body, your soul, your mind is in torment, and all, just about all your hope has dissipated. And to make matters worse, you get here and your soul is in danger. It is not how long you journey between lost hope. It's not a long journey between lost hope and lost belief, or the belief that God is not good. Someone's rightly said that every sin has his root in a failure to believe that God is good. That's true. And when you get to this point in life and everything is darkness and God hasn't answered your prayer, and it just feels like the wilderness will never end and I will always be hunted and nothing's going to happen, it's really easy to go from there, say, God's not good. If anybody had a right to say that, it would be Job. I don't know if you remember the story of Job, but if you read in the book of Job, he was a rich guy, wonderful family, life was going well. All of a sudden, everything collapses. Most of his kids are killed. He loses his farm. His body breaks out and boils. Dark night of the soul. And worst of all, Job has his friends, and his friends come along and say, Job, yeah, we see that you're going through stuff. It must be because you did something wrong. Job's comforters. In that dark end of the soul, Job's wife comes to him and says, Job, you've lost everything. Why don't you just curse God and die? Curse God and die. That's the danger when you're right here, in that dark night of the soul. But Job says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Even if I'm killed by him, I am going to put my hope in him. There's a time when I walked through this dark night of the soul. Darkness was my companion. I had little hope. I chose to say, God, I came to this point, walk away from everything. Or say, God, I'm going to trust you. When I said, God, I'm going to trust you, nothing changed overnight. But then in the darkness, I started to get glimpses of the glory of God. And I saw his love and his graciousness. And I saw his benevolence in ways that, well, I knew that he didn't have to show them. There were some times when I thought, oh, I see light. I see why God is doing some of what he's doing. I see why he allows this to continue. And there were other times when I was completely, completely baffled. There were so many times when I felt like my prayer was unanswered. Even went to my spiritual director and said, the gospel isn't working for me. But though he slay me, yet will I trust him. And I said, why, Lord, why? I realize that there's some stuff that I will never understand until I get to heaven. But the further down the path I got, the further out of the wilderness I wandered. And I realized that we live by faith, not by sight. We live by faith that God is good in the middle of the darkness. And you don't doubt the truth. You don't doubt the truth that you learned in light when you're in the middle of the darkness. And God was gracious and hauled me out of the wilderness. Life is still a mystery in some ways, but I know this: God is good. That's the conclusion David came to, verse 5. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. David said, I'm going to trust in your unfailing love. I'm going to worship you. He didn't get to this in the course of just sitting down one afternoon and writing out this psalm. This was over time. David said, I'm going to trust in your unfailing love. I'm going to worship you for being good to me. Let me walk you through the process of lament. So you've got your complaint towards God. You've got the stuff that feels like it's killing you on the inside. Instead of denying or detaching or drugging yourself, our call is to make a complaint to God. God can handle it. God, I'm angry, I'm sad, I'm hurt, I'm frustrated, I feel betrayed. God, how long will you hide your face from me? Will you forget me forever? Why, God, I can't see you, I can't find you. And then state what it's doing to you. It's the next step. I wrestle with my thoughts. God, this is what's going on inside me. To do this, you're going to have to identify your feelings. Instead of denying that you have feelings or detaching from your feelings, you're saying, God, this is what's going on in me. And you sit in the middle of those feelings. You face those feelings head on. God, I feel alone. I feel angry. I feel hurt. Lord, you see the doubt. Then you tell God what you want him to do. Look on me and answer. Out of the middle of your feelings, you don't wait for your feelings to get better. You just name your feelings and tell the Lord what you want him to do. Lord, look at me and answer me. I need you to come through for me. I need you to work on this situation. I need you to heal my heart. After you've told God what you want him to do, when you've done that, move to an expression of faith. And it may take time to get from an expression of faith in him from those other steps. But push towards it. I'm going to trust in you. I'm choosing to trust in you. But I will trust in your unfailing love and express gratitude. My heart will rejoice. If you look at the Psalm of Lament, most of them follow this pattern. There's a number of Psalms of Lament in the Psalms. This is how you lament. It's also appropriate to do this in community. This isn't only a solitary thing. This is a thing to be done in community as well. You know, many of the evils of this world go beyond our private domain. We lament the war in Israel and in the Ukraine. We lament what we see as injustice in the Congo and the oppression of the persecuted church. it's good and right and proper to lament together to God. I know some of you find yourself in dark places. It's okay to feel that way. Name what you're feeling and take your feeling to God in that process of lament. Instead of denying or detaching or drugging yourself, deal with your stuff before God. If you do this, you'll move into a healthy place, a place of healthy emotionally and spiritually. I'm going to ask Linda to come, and she's going to remind us of this psalm once again. And then after she does that, we are going to walk through a prayer of lament together.
Look on me and answer, Lord.
practice this prayer of lament. I want to picture you to picture in your mind something you want to lament. It might be in your personal life. It might be for something that's wrong in the world. But I want to invite you to come, and we're going to pray this together. So, with every head bowed and eyes closed, I'm just going to lead you through this prayer of lament. How long, O Lord, how long? Just reach out to God and tell him your complaint. Name the problem, the situation, circumstance. Tell him what it's doing to you. How you feel. And ask God to tell him what you want him to do. Then express your faith and your gratitude for what he has done. You're putting your trust in him. Amen.
Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice, you became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again.
Morning, we come before you to take part in communion. And I want you to know, if you're here and you've invited Jesus into your life, you're more than welcome to take part in communion with us. When Jesus hung on the cross, he said seven things. One of them was, my God, why have you forsaken me? That's a direct quote from Psalm 22, a psalm of lament. He's going through this, and he laments. And yet he gets through it, and for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He did it for you. The Bible instructs us before we come to the Lord, that before the table, that we should examine our hearts, and if there's something that's not right between him and us, that we should confess it, knowing that when we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin. Let's pray. Lord, we've been in your presence, and we're asking, Lord, if there's anything else we need to confess, we bring it to you now. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. Amen. I received from the Lord that which I also passed on to you. The Lord, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And after he broke it, he gave thanks and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Lord Jesus, we consecrate these elements that we're about to take, knowing that they symbolize your body and your blood. And as we ingest these symbols into our into our bodies, we're asking that you would strengthen us, body, soul, and spirit. Pour out your grace towards us so that whatever life brings, we can walk with you well. Ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward, and I'm going to ask that you hold on to the elements until we can all take part in them together. Take the wafer in your hand. I've been reminded time and time again, in the dark things of life, the dark times of life, I can walk through them because Jesus walked through them before me. He broke, his body was broken for us. Take, eat, remembering what Christ has done for us. Open up the cup. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for us. In him we have found life, even when life is dark, because we know that he can give us the strength. And the power of the cross of Christ goes deeper than anything life can throw away. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ was shed for you. Take, drink, remembering what he's done for you. And Lord Jesus, we give thanks. Amen.
Stand with us as we close off the service.
I am to worship. Here I am to battle. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
And so, Lord, we've been in your presence. We've remembered that you've died for us. We've walked through some of the dark places in life and seen how we need to walk through as people of God. Lord, I pray for those who are feeling life's hard times most keenly. Be their presence and their guide. I'm asking for all of us, Lord, as we go into this week, that we would see your power and grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.